It's church.
I can't come to church until I get my life together.
Church is how I got my life together.
Church is filled with a bunch of hypocrites.
And there's always room for one more.
All they care about is your money.
They care about me, not about my money.
Is there some kind of dress code?
Yes, the code is wear some clothes.
Church, it just makes me nervous.
I was nervous at first, and then I felt right at home.
I'm not sure I believe everything that you believe.
But you can still belong.
Church is for wimpy, girly men.
You want to say that again?
If you knew me and what I've done, you wouldn't want me.
If you knew me and what I've done, you wouldn't be worried.
You can come to my church even if you were brought up Catholic,
Baptist,
Methodist,
Jewish,
Mormon,
Lutheran,
Pentecostal,
Presbyterian,
Church of Christ,
Southern Baptist.
A little bit of everything and a whole lot of nothing.
See, it's not about a religion, it's about a relationship.
So please, come to my church.
Where nobody's perfect.
Where beginners are welcome.
Where socks are optional, but grace is required.
Where forgiveness is offered.
Where hope is alive.
And where it's okay to not be okay. Really.
Well, amen. What a good way to start. And we're done. Yeah. Pastor, we thought we'd show them our strength. Okay, never mind. So we're gonna begin worship this morning, singing to our King in heaven. So we invite you to worship, whether it's on your feet, in your chair, on your knees.
Jesus, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done here in us. Jesus, there is no one greater. You alone are Savior. Show the world your heaven come down, King of heaven come down.
Voices just coming up here, and I just love it.
Thank you.
Next week, everybody gets a mic.
I was way back there, so she wasn't talking about mine. So, this morning, guys, I just want to welcome you guys that are here in person, and those of you that are watching. The camera used to be over here, so I looked this way. Those of you that are watching online, we are glad that you are here as well. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for being part of our time of worship together, worshiping the risen Jesus. So thank you for being here. Our scripture today comes out of Psalms chapter 9, and it's verses 4 through, whoops, nope. I got little tiny little verse numbers in my Bible, and if I don't look right, we're looking at 9 through 11 this morning. The Lord also will be a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble, and those who know your name will put their trust in you. For you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. Sing praises to the Lord who dwells in Zion. Declare among the people his deeds. Let's pray this morning. Heavenly Father, as we open up our service this morning, as we begin this time of worship, Lord, we ask that we are able to put away everything that's outside of that, all the things that need to be done today and this week, things that are coming up, so that we can focus only on worshiping you this morning. Clear our minds, Lord. Help us focus. Help us just get at the foot of the throne this morning, Lord, and be able to worship you. We thank you, Lord, for who you are and what you've done. And Lord, we thank you for what you are going to do. This morning, Lord, we want it to be about you and only about you. So we pray all this in your name this morning. Amen.
Storm. He is Lord.
rest on His unchanging grace.
Goosebumps when I sing the words of that song, and just the power in the name of Jesus that we're going to stand before the throne of God. What a blessed day.
Jesus.
so I wait for you. So I wait for you. So I wait for you. Lord, I wait for you. I'm falling on my knees, offering all of me. Jesus, you're all this heart is living for. I'm falling on my knees, offering all of me. Jesus, you're all this heart is living for.
So often, so hungry. This world offers us nothing, God, nothing that is of substance. And yet we see people chasing after the wealth and the fame, different things, God. They don't mean anything. Our life is worth, yes, we seek you, God. As my brother shared, we seek you. We need you. And Lord, we fall to our knees. What a marvelous day, Lord Jesus, when we are face to face. When we can examine for ourselves the nail scars in your hands and feet. And all that you've done. And all that you continue to do for us. Thank you, God, that we are never alone. We hunger for you, God, and I pray that we continue to just reach to you for that hunger and thirst and nothing else. We look forward to the day, Lord, when we see you. We praise you in the precious holy name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song. song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you.
Morning.
Good morning.
Pastor asked me to share where the power of prayer really touched my life. And first off, I want to read out of Psalm 62, verses 5 to 8. Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress, and I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in Him at all times, O people. Pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge. When back in 1989, we sold our home in Guerneville and moved to the wilderness in Oregon. And it was quite an adventure. And 10 months later, that log cabin burned to the ground. And we were out there in the wilderness, camping, with no idea about our future, and six kids. Everybody was really miserable. It was in the 90s. There were horse flies just biting everyone. And the hardest thing about a house fire is we lost everything that you get used to for comfort, that special chair, whatever it is, a stuffed animal. So everyone's trying to adjust to this. Plus, I found out I was pregnant 3 days after the house burned. So I was sicker than a dog during this time. And a friend had come up and brought us groceries. And we've been living a lot on donations, what people have given. And after a few days, after my friend had left, I thought, I've got to cook that roast. And my daughters that were 14 and 16 had been doing a lot of the cooking. I couldn't be in the kitchen. And the smell of that burnt house, it was just nauseating to everyone. So finally, I just thought, I'm making this meal. I cooked this meal. And the whole time I'm cooking, everyone's fighting. We're miserable. And it was before the days of therapy to help you through these giant tragedies that are common now. And I just turned the stove off when it was done, and I looked at my girls and said, you guys serve dinner. I have to go find God. And I was so feeling lost, and I went out in the middle of this river, five rivers, and it was much different than the Russian River, lots of rapids, and I waded out to some rocks in the middle, and for 20 minutes I screamed at God, and I was so angry at him that, you know, I thought I was following him, and we had this horrible tragedy in our life. Thank God we didn't lose any children, but I gave my Christian, I call it my Christian resume to him. I've been so good, faithfully serving you. I've been teaching Bible studies and missionettes and doing tithes and offerings and going to every church meeting I could get to and praying and, you know, letting God know that I was doing it right for him. Why did he do this to me? And I screamed at him, I don't think I even believe in you anymore. And I was so disheartened, and I just sat down on that rock and I was crying and so spent. And after a little bit, I noticed, you know, as the torrents are coming over these rocks, these little creatures about this big, I'm watching them, and they're not getting knocked off. And I said to this God, I, a few minutes before, said, I don't believe it. I was like, God, how come those guys aren't getting knocked off the rock? And he said, well, that's what I want you to do. Cling to the rock. That's all I'm asking you to do right now, is cling to the rock of your salvation. And that this verse, again, my soul finds rest in God alone. My salvation comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress, and I will never be shaken. And we've been through so many hard times and tragedies since, but he gave me that word of life to hold on to, that I cling to the rock, Jesus.
Amen. Thank you, Sue. Sue's one of the prayer warriors in our church, and I'm sure that she had a really tough time sorting through all the amazing times of prayer that she has had to be able to share that one with us. I'm not sure why my water is in my shirt pocket, but I just noticed when I looked down, it was there. I was like, is that a growth? Or nope, it was my water. But thank you again, Sue, for sharing that with us.
Hey, Doug said I only went 3 minutes. You want me back up there?
I had told Sue 3 to 5 minutes, and she goes, there's no way I can do that. And I said, well, you know, I can always do my sermon next week. And since it was only 3 minutes long, she was volunteering to come back up here again. But you're already sitting down there, so that's all right. We'll move on from there. So good morning. I'm glad you guys are here. Last week we started a short series on the book of Jonah, and we looked at the first chapter of Jonah, and we looked at how God, in spite of the sins of the city of Nineveh, wanted to save the people, and we looked at the prophet God called to deliver his message of repentance, Jonah, who was just hanging out at home while the city was falling to pieces. And we looked at the condition of Jonah's heart when, instead of doing what God asked him to do, ran in the opposite direction. And we looked at God's great love for Jonah, a love so great that he sent a great storm to try to bring Jonah back into a relationship with him. And when that didn't work, he sent a great fish to swallow him. And that's where chapter 1 ended. And Nineveh was located on the east bank of the Tigris River. It was a huge city, and it covered a large area of land. Historians often differ on the population of the city in Jonah's time, but the estimates range from 600,000 to 120,000 people inhabited Nineveh at the time. So God calls Jonah, who Jesus identifies as a prophet, to go deliver his judgment on the sin and evil in the city. So Jonah takes off, not to Nineveh, where God wanted him to go, but as far away as he could go. And God had more trouble getting his own prophet to do what he wanted him to do than he did getting the city of Nineveh to repent. He heads to Joppa to catch a boat on his way to Tarshish. And he gets into the boat, sleeps in the boat during a storm, gets tossed overboard and swallowed by a fish. And that was chapter 1. If you missed last week's message, you can watch it on our Facebook page, our website, or on our YouTube page and get caught up, or you can just read it for yourself. by opening up chapter 1. And later, I want you to read it later, not right now. You have to pay attention to today's message. Then you can go back and read chapter 1. But we're going to look at today at Jonah's prayer. We're going to break it down into three parts this morning: where Jonah prayed, why he prayed, and when he prayed. And we're going to get this started this morning by looking at Jonah, starting in chapter 2, starting in verse 1. I'm going to be reading out of the New American Standard Translation this morning. You can follow along in whatever translation that you have. The words might be a little different, but the meaning is going to be the same. If you don't have your Bible handy, that's okay. You can just listen as the scripture is read, then go back later this week and read it for yourself. That way you can hear it read and then read it for yourselves, and that'll help it get deep into your heart and mind. And one of the first verses I ever memorized was Psalms 119:11. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. See, when we memorize scripture, when we meditate on it, when we really focus on what God is saying to us, it becomes a part of who we are. It becomes part of our thought process, our actions, our way of living. And it's amazing when we're faced with temptation how often scripture will come back to our minds to help us overcome that temptation. A young boy desperately wanted a bicycle for Christmas, so he asked his parents for the bike. And his parents wanted to teach him an important lesson and teach him the importance of prayer. So they suggested to the young boy that he should write a letter to Jesus and pray for one instead. Not pleased with the response of his parents, he immediately threw a temper tantrum. Sounds like a little bit more than just sending him to his room was needed there. But they went ahead and sent him to his room. And once he was in his room, he decided to take his parents' advice and he wrote a letter to Jesus. And he wrote, "Dear Jesus, I've been a good boy this year and would love a new bicycle. Can you see if I can have a new bicycle? Your friend, Johnny." But Johnny knew that Jesus probably knew what kind of boy he really was and how he had been that year. So he ripped up the letter and he decided to give it another try. So this time he wrote, "Dear Jesus, I've been an okay boy this year and I want a new bicycle. Yours truly, Johnny." Well, Johnny knew this wasn't totally honest, so he tore it up and he tried again and he said, "Dear Jesus, I've thought about being a good boy this year. Can I have a bicycle anyway? Signed, Johnny." He looked deep down into his heart, which, by the way, was what his parents really wanted in the first place. And he knew he had been a bad boy and hoped he would receive something simply because Jesus loved him. So he crumpled up the letter, he threw it in the trash can. He went downstairs where his mother had a nativity set on the fireplace on the mantle. He took the statue of Mary, wrapped it in a blanket, and hid it under its bed. And then he wrote this letter: "Dear Jesus, if you ever want to see your mother again, give me a bicycle." So we're going to get into our passage this morning by looking at chapter 2 of Jonah. We're going to start in verse 1. The first thing we're going to look at in Jonah's prayer this morning is where Jonah prayed. So we're going to read verses 1 and 2. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the stomach of the fish, and he said, "I called out of my distress to the Lord, and he answered me. I cried for help from the depths of Sheol, and you heard my voice." See, scripture says that he prayed from deep inside the fish. And I would guess that not very many people have prayed from the inside of the belly of a fish before. It seems a strange place to be praying. When we think about praying, we usually think about praying in church or in our homes, or for me in my truck on the way to work at camp. But in all of my Christian life, I've never prayed while in the belly of a fish. It's probably a rare place to pray because the stomach of a fish is not a place where anyone would choose to go to pray. But it was where Jonah found himself, so it is where he began to pray. And even from the belly of a fish, Jonah knows that God heard his prayer. See, there's two great lessons that we can learn from Jonah's place of prayer. And the first is that God hears us anywhere. There's no place that we can go, nowhere that we can run, no circumstance that we can find ourselves where God cannot hear us. Sometimes we feel as if we've moved so far away from God that he couldn't possibly hear us. That we've placed so much sin, so much stuff between us, that there's no way that God would ever listen to us. He wouldn't want to hear from us after all the stuff that we've done. But when we begin to think like that, we need to remember Jonah. Remember his disobedience, his thinking that he could run from God, his self-centeredness, his uncaring for the lives of those in Nineveh. Yet God pursued him. When we feel like we are unworthy of God listening to us because of all our baggage, we need to remember that God loves us and desires that we come back to him. When we feel as if we have run from him and what he has asked us to do, when we feel as if we are on our way to Tarshish, when we feel as if we have been swallowed by our lives and our mistakes, he's right there beside us. He's waiting. He's using circumstances to help bring us back to him. And guess what? When we reach out to him, we are not put on hold. We're not told that we have to get our house in order before he's willing to listen to our prayers. He listens when we pray, wherever we are. And I'm sure glad of that. The second lesson we can learn here, that it's far better for us to pray in normal surroundings than it is to wait until we're in the belly of a fish. So often, we reserve our prayers for times of crisis. We wait until we have no other way out before we call on him. A fisherman went out to sea with his companions when a storm came up and threatened to sink their ship. His friends begged him to pray, but he said, "It's been a long time since I've done that or even entered a church." But at their insistence, however, he finally cried out, "Oh Lord, I haven't asked anything of you for 15 years, and if you can help us now and bring us back safely, I promise I will not bother you for another 15 years. Unfortunately, many people see prayer as an escape mechanism rather than a constant line of communication with God. If we wait until we are in a bad situation to pray, it's usually because we waited until a bad situation to pray. And when we don't spend time talking to our God regularly, we tend to drift. Two boys were playing in the snow one day when one said to the other, "Hey, let's see who can make the straightest path in the snow." His friend agreed because, you know, there were boys and we make everything a contest. But one boy focused his eye on a tree and he walked towards it without taking his eyes off of it. The other boy focused on the tree as well and he started off, but he hadn't gone very far when he began to wonder how straight his path was. So he looked over his shoulder and he went a little further and again turned to see how he was doing. And when they arrived at their stopping place, the boy stopped and looked back. One path was straight as an arrow while the other ran in a zigzag course. "How did you get your path so straight?" asked the boy who had made the crooked steps. The other boy said, "I just set my eyes on the tree and kept them there until I got to the end, while you stopped and looked back and wandered off your course." See, this is a perfect picture of the Christian life. If we fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, then we'll be able to walk a straight path in life. We're going to move on to our next lesson. So look with me at verse 2 once again. And the lesson here is why Jonah prayed. So we're going to look at verses 2 through 6 here. Little tiny little numbers. And he said, "I called out of my distress to the Lord, and he answered me. I cried for help from the depths of Sheol. You heard my voice, for you had cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the current engulfed me. All of your breakers and billows passed over me. So I said, I have been expelled from your sight. Nevertheless, I will look again towards your holy temple. Water encompassed me to the point of death. The great deep engulfed me. Weeds were wrapped around my head, and I descended to the roots of the mountains. The earth with its bars was around me forever. But you have bought up my life from the pit, O Lord my God." See, this sounds like a no-brainer, doesn't it? He prayed because he'd been swallowed by a big old smelly fish. It seems like that would be reason enough why he prayed. I think it's been a while since Jonah had spent any time in prayer before this. He thought if he could just avoid God by not spending any time in prayer and just get far enough away, maybe God would just forget about him. So he was fleeing from God and he had been neglecting his spiritual responsibilities. Have you had a time in your life where you were involved in something that maybe you shouldn't have been? Maybe drifting a little too? So what do we do? We probably stop going to church so often. We probably don't talk as often with other believers. And we don't pray as often. As if we think that maybe God won't notice that we've kind of just faded away. It's like Adam and Eve after their sin. They hid themselves from God in the garden thinking that maybe God wouldn't notice. They were missing. You know, the only two people in the world and God wouldn't notice. But that's what Jonah did, and that's what we still do today. God brought the storm as a way of disciplining Jonah, a way of bringing him back into a relationship with himself. And when that didn't work, God brought the fish. And inside the stomach of the fish, Jonah realized that he can't outrun God. Verse 2 says that he called to God because of his great distress. The King James says, by reason of mine affliction. See, Jonah was in great distress. He was in the fish's stomach, after all. But listen to some of the ways that he describes his distress in the verses that we just read. And I'm going to use the King James translation for these because the language is just so descriptive and it sounds really cool. In verse 2, Jonah says, out of the belly of hell I cried I. In verse 3, he writes, cast into the deep, and the floods encompassed me about. And he also says in verse 3, thy billows and waves passed over me. Let me read to you what he says in verse 5. The waters encompassed me about, even to the soul. The depth closed me round about, and the weeds were wrapped around my head. See, this was a man who understood the situation that he found himself in. He understood that he found himself in that situation because of his own sin and his own disobedience. Jonah kind of sounds like a slow learner, but aren't we all? Where has God had to bring you so that your relationship with him could be fixed? What has he had to bring into your life to get your attention? We're going to move on to the third and final part of our look this morning at Jonah's prayer. But before we do that, let's recap what we've learned so far. We looked at where Jonah prayed. It doesn't matter if it's beside your bed at night or in the belly of a fish. God hears us when we pray. Secondly, we looked at why Jonah prayed. He was praying because he got himself in a situation that he couldn't get himself out of. Jonah was praying because in running from God, he had gotten lost. He knew that only through God could his relationship with God be repaired. Now we're going to look at verses 7 through 10, where we're going to look at when Jonah prayed. Jonah tells us in this prayer quite a bit here. While I was fainting away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you into your holy temple. Those who regard vain idols forsake their faithfulness, but I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. That which I have vowed, I will pay. Salvation is from the Lord. Then the Lord commanded the fish, and it vomited Jonah up onto dry land. So Jonah tells us in this prayer that he began to pray when he was fainting away. Fainting away. It sounds like something Scarlett O'Hara might have done in Gone with the Wind. The Good News version translates it this way. When I felt my life slipping away, then, O Lord, I prayed to you. So when Jonah felt that his time had come, it was then that he turned to God. When the storm threatened to sink the ship with those innocent, well, as innocent as a bunch of sailors could be in those days, Jonah was too stubborn to give in to God. But when they threw him overboard into the raging sea, and he began to sink, and his life began to flash before his eyes, and he knew there was no way to save himself, no way out, that's when he began to pray. Why do we do that? Why do we wait until there's no way out before turning to God? See, there's an old saying, they say that it originated out of the First World War, but they really don't know who said it first. And the old saying goes like this, there are no atheists in a foxhole. Meaning that when your life is on the line, everyone wants to believe in a God. And I'm sure glad that God, he's not like me. See, I would be saying to all those people, well, too bad for you guys. You should have listened to me in the first place. But God's not like me, and I'm so glad of that. See, Jonah felt the end fast approaching. No more running from God. No more turning a deaf ear to God. Jonah, right here, reminds me of the prodigal son. When he had nowhere else to go, nowhere else to turn, he returns to the Father. And that's what Jonah was doing here. Jonah has a change of heart. See, he begins focusing not on his own situation that wasn't looking good for him, but instead focused on the glory of God. And he begins thinking in terms of, I remembered the Lord, or I will sacrifice to you with a voice of thanksgiving. So other terms he uses in this passage is, that which I have vowed I will pay, and salvation is from the Lord. And guess what? God hears him and responds to his call. Again, I'm so glad that God doesn't respond the way that I do. I would have told him, too little, too late, dude, sorry. But God loves us so much that he hears our every utterance. I read this little thing online, and I guess it was really meant more for Mother's Day. But as I read it, I realized it was very appropriate for what we're talking about here this morning. And it goes like this, and I paraphrased it a little. When a mom has a sick child, her ears are tuned in to the slightest sound that a child makes. We wonder how she can go with so little sleep when her child is sick. A sick child in the middle of the night doesn't even need to cry out for water or even speak because she is there. A change in their breathing that no one else would notice, she does. She hears because her ears are tuned to her child's heart. And just like the mother tending her sick child, when one of his creations begin to long for the things of God, God's ear is already tuned into that person's heart. He will hear it. There's not been a cry out to him on this earth at any time that he has not heard. And this chapter ends with Jonah once again on dry land. He's been delivered by God. The question is, where does he go from here? Will his newfound, renewed relationship with God cause him to willingly fulfill his mission that God has given him in Nineveh? Or will he take the opportunity to continue his escape to Tarshish? I say Tarshish a lot just because it's kind of a fun word to say, Tarshish. Pay no attention to my stopping there. We're going to learn next week that a second call from God comes to Jonah to go to Nineveh. God's call is renewed to Jonah. What a great lesson that for us to learn as well. See, it's never too late to serve God. Even when we have wandered or fled from our relationship with God, when we've turned back to him, not only are we forgiven, but we can be used by him again. We don't have to re-earn his trust. He knows our heart. He knows the innermost workings of our minds. He knows our motives. When our relationship with him is fixed, God moves on. He doesn't bring up the past when we stumble. Most of us are not as good as God at leaving the past in the past. We have trouble trusting someone who has hurt us or in some way wronged us. And we even have a hard time trusting anyone at all when we've gone through a hard time. But for God, when we repent, when we turn 180 degrees from our sin and towards him, when we turn our backs on our sin and move towards reconciliation with him, God forgives and moves forward without holding our failings over our heads. We, on the other hand, sometimes are just waiting for the opportunity to bring it back up with those that we have said that we have forgiven. When we compare our character with God's character, we don't come out too well, do we? But that's okay, because we are a work in progress, just trying to be more like Jesus. If God's been speaking to you this morning through his word or through the music, you need to respond to him. Why would you put the creator of the universe on hold while you decide whether or not you want to respond to him? Maybe this morning you need to be praying, asking from whatever place that you are, wherever place that you find yourself this morning. And even if that place is where you find yourself after running from your relationship with him, you need to pray. Maybe you find yourself like Jonah did, seeing no way out of the choices that you've made for your life. If this is where you are, you need to be like Jonah and turn to the one who can save. Or maybe you're wondering if God can even hear your prayers because you're buried so deep under the ruins that you've made of your life. If God can hear Jonah in the belly of the fish, he can hear you wherever you are. If you've never made Jesus Lord and Savior of your life, this can be the morning that changes for you. It changes your life and your eternity. Grab a Bible and look at what it says about who Jesus is. Look at what Jesus says about himself. If you'd like to talk to someone about where to begin reading in your Bible or what it means to be a follower of Jesus, talk to anyone here after we close. And if you're watching from home or on a device somewhere, you can message us on any of our social media platforms or on our website. See, we would love to share with you what Jesus has done in our lives and how you can experience the forgiveness and salvation offered through him. And if there are prayer requests that you might have, you can put them in the offering box on the table in the back, or you can also send them to us on those same social media platforms as well as on our website. But whatever God has put on your heart today, respond as he leads. May God have his will in each of our lives today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for who you are. We thank you so much for what you've done. Lord, we thank you that you love us even though we're not perfect. That you love us even though we mess up time after time. Lord, that we thank you that you can hear us even when we're in the belly of a ruined life. Lord, I pray that wherever we are right now, wherever we are in our relationship with you, Lord, that we can just step back and realize that you can still hear us and that we cry out to you, Lord, and that we work it. All we need is to take one step towards you, Lord, and you are there. Lord, if there are broken relationships with you this morning, Lord, I pray for strength, Lord, to overcome those, to be willing to let go, to quit focusing on the mistakes that we've made and the ruins that we are living in, but instead focus on your forgiveness and your salvation. Lord, you love Jonah so much to pursue him. Lord, you love us so much that you are there, that you are chasing us, you are pursuing us. All we need to do is turn towards you. Lord, we thank you for the service today. We thank you for the opportunity that we've had to spend together worshiping you. And we ask now, Lord, as we go into our final song and our benediction, Lord, that when we walk out those doors, when we turn off our devices, when we start scrolling to the next thing, Lord, that we don't forget what you've said to us this morning. That what you have said is how much you love us. Lord, we give you our hearts, we give you our minds. Lord, we give you our lives this morning. We pray all this in your name. Amen.
Well, it don't
so loved the world, he sent his only son to save all. And all the people said amen.
Today comes out of Romans 15:13, and it's out of the Good News Translation today. May God, the source of hope, fill you with all joy and peace by means of your faith in Him, so that your hope will continue to grow by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.